YouTube seems has a delay. Like,
yeah.
why? Is it like a buffer, maybe?
Yeah, this buffering. 8 minutes. I'm not quite sure. I've never done this before.
Yeah, I tried to. Maybe we just go. Okay, now it went live.
It went away.
Went away.
So we'll get. I don't know how to tell if you had one upload.
Live from you. Okay, there we go.
Oh, you did do it.
Okay, we are live now. Okay, let me just with this so we can see that this is my control panel. I can control it. Okay. Hello everybody on YouTube. You're watching a live workshop with Terry from my online class. Now she's live with me in person in my home studio. We're doing together a Gombe painting practice from a real photograph of a magnolia, mountain magnolia, right? It's a wild magnolia. It's beautiful. I never seen this kind of magnolia before. I'll maybe put this photo, still picture, on my Facebook later, in my class, online class later. So the first thing Terry did before, because she's a very good student, to make the process much faster, so we don't have to do this initial step. So she cropped the picture on Photoshop, on the computer, in Photoshop. So you kind of rearrange it so you can select the petals, the buds, and the full bloom, half bloom, different angle. That's perfect. And she made a drawing in pencil, right? This is a printout from that pencil. So this is the first step. It's very important. You have to select from this real picture the only part that's usable or you like to use in Gombe paint. So it's not a realistic copy, like a photograph of the original picture, but you have to reorganize it. Speaking of composition, I think Terry did an excellent to add this branch so that it will start from one of the eight positions, I call it eight positions of starting off a branch in my class. So there are eight positions, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Eight positions, except the middle, the center, you know, avoid the middle. So if you fold the picture, you'll see more, nine squares, and you'll see the positions.
I actually didn't plan that, so that worked out well.
Yeah, that's very important. So even when you take a photograph of a stem of a flower, any plant, you need to be aware where it starts, you know. And I have so many friends sharing the flower photograph on the internet. I don't really see this. If you see my photograph, I always cut up, the line, cut the branch from one of these eight positions, and the finish should be complete. The top of the branch should be complete within the frame, but the starting point should be outside the frame, and it comes in, from one of the eight places. All right? That's a very. I will give you A by the way for doing this composition.
Thank you.
So composition counts actually more than half of my score in my scoring system. That's 50. Without doing any drawing, any other steps, you already earned that composition. Okay, here's what we will do next. We'll trace it with you can use pencil, to do another drawing, to transfer it onto a piece of sized rice paper, which we call it shigata. It's very thin. It has one shiny side with a sparkler, a little tiny glitters, you can see that. That's called a mika. And let me see, I have this tape, it's perfect. So we're going to tape it. So I kind of crop it again because the computer paper is not exactly the painting paper, which is equal to a scroll size. So we're going to mount it onto a scroll eventually. So we will reposition it so that I think maybe a little higher. So the starting point should be still on number one. So I just honor this corner, so just leave more room on top, maybe.
Do you think so? Start at the bottom.
Maybe a little bit more.
A
little bit more on the bottom. But let me see. What do you think?
I was thinking more space on top.
More space on top. Yeah, so that's basically you honor the left corner, right?
Yeah.
Okay, that's good. That's the same way I was thinking. So this is good. I'll tape this. You can use this. Just tape on the left side. Make sure this starting point outside the cut.
Oh, you
the
want it outside?
I mean, yeah, I don't want it inside. That's
okay.
That's the point. You have to start from one of the positions on the border,
okay.
Not inside the paper. Okay. So you can use that if you want. And I have this light box. I just show you how it looks like. It's much clearer, but sometimes it make your eyes uncomfortable. But this is up to you. You can use without it, because the paper is so thin, you don't have to use it. Okay. I think I would probably use it. I want high tech kind of look. At least I have another one. If you want, you can borrow mine. Do you want to just use?
I'm just gonna use the felt.
Oh, you can use, okay, just tape it on the
felt.
Okay. Yeah, just feel, just position it so you will not move around. If you do this, you can, I always try to, let me do this. You can use a pencil to trace it on the, trace it first lightly, and then do that with ink. That's the standard way. So you can only do the pencil drawing. You can just draw with ink. What do you think? Yeah. What do you think? To save time, we can do that.
I think we can draw directly on.
Okay. Yeah, because if you don't worry about this one, not good through. So your master copy template, whatever, and it should be still okay. Do you have a liner? We have several kind of. You can use a small visual brush. If you have that one, the red one,
red bean.
Yeah, red bean is what.
I also have.
Let me show you what. The most common one is the small visual brush from the basic three. We have a smaller visual brush. It's like very short hair visual brush. Let me show people. Camera, if you can see better. These are the lining brushes. We can also use what we call the three sheep. I don't have three sheep. Three wolf. Seven wolf three sheep brush, but I don't have that in hand. So yeah, you can just use a small weasel brush. I have several small weasel brush. That's a basic brush. you know, if you like, you can borrow my, or you can just use that red bean brush.
Is that
I'll use the same brush as you do, so maybe
okay.
Red bean brush, right?
Okay.
Okay, let's wet the brush first, and you can use a paper towel to dry. Can you go there to grab one? Just on the counter, over the counter there. Okay. We will use this ink we can share. That's the calligraphy ink we have left. This is a little too much, so we don't need that much. Just use the palette to, I can use this one. This is safe for the color. You can use this for the, you know, like adjusting your brush, this palette, the lid. So I do have a little bit like peach sap glue here. Left. It's a useful one just instantly. When you have something like left over from, this is not so old. If you have old ink, you can add a little peach sap just to resituate it. Anyway, I will get a dark gray, but not pure black for the petals. Okay, for the petals. Yeah, you can use the same ink. Just load the whole brush. You don't have to gradate it. Just the whole thing, and then you squeeze out the extra. This paper is not going to bleed, so it's okay as long as the tip is pointed. Okay, I better have my glasses on. So let me focus on my hand. Okay, here we go. All right. I'm going to start from this. Before you do that, join, you know, you need to read very carefully the photograph. I don't really want to combine these two petals. I do want to separate them. So which one is in the front is very important. The which one is overlapped on top.
This,
you know. Yeah, this two
petals. I think it's a split petal.
Is it split?
I think so.
No, I think I'm looking at the picture right there. So it's.
Oh, it is two separate.
Two separate.
Okay.
Yeah.
I do it split.
Yeah. So that kind of thing, you have to have a thorough understanding. Otherwise, the scientist will pick on you. So let me show you. So I'll make the top one in front, or the, I can do the opposite. Maybe the big one on the front, the small one behind. Okay, either one it should work. I think on the picture the small one actually is in front. Let me do that. Let me just follow the picture. So here's the difference between a contour drawing, a pencil drawing, and the Chinese gombi outline. We call it fine line. Just like calligraphy, there's a starting and ending, and in the between the two points, you're supposed not to stop, right?
Right.
So you don't draw the entire contour in one stroke. You have to take a, you know, hold your breath to start. I always start from the tip of the petal, and you can leave a little break between two sides. They always have this kind of split, maybe you call it. So you don't want to close that starting point. So you start from the tip and from both one side and then the other. And you can leave a little space. That's always, if you look at real flower, they actually have this little little thing in between. So it's not a smooth, seamless start, right? Okay, so the top line first, start with the dot, hide the tip, right? And you try to do it as sturdy as possible, as smooth as possible. Don't have to be very thick, but in the beginning I do have a little dot. The end, you need to hide the tip still, you know, you don't want to make a sharp, and it could be, you don't have to be with pulse dots there, but it's the idea to hide the tip. Okay. And the second one, the left side, I can leave a little space between the two petals. I just go straight through, so it's a, okay, I think maybe a little bit darker.
See, mine's really light.
I know, I realize that.
Okay.
So let me get some more. You know, it's good to go lighter than darker, I think. No, I don't want to, because it's a white flower.
That's right? True.
Yeah, if you do dark purple, then you can go dark. So the second one, left side, I realized that I hold the brush too low, so you can hold the brush higher, so you get more, you know, when you draw a long line, you may raise your wrist and even your arm above the table. Okay, here's an example of the two sides. You should have, I think this is a clear. It's not so clear, but I think you did very nicely the lines. So I will make this clear. So I do the edge on along the top line, the inside, you know, first. And then a little bit on the bottom. Okay, that's a nice touch. Okay. I'm just afraid too dark. Okay, this is a nice petal. This one looks like there's a deep cut. That makes my point very clear that, you know, the two sides should should have an open.
Right.
It's a what we call to let the chi travel. You know, you don't close the ends. So this is what I do. I start from the middle, then go up a little bit, and then down. It's like a little M, right? You can leave the bottom of the end open. Okay. Just start with a little pulse. Little pulse. Okay. Let's do this one. So you always identify where the tip is now, right? Okay, look at this one. It's not right on the middle. In the middle, it's a little in the perspective. So the line is a little bit on the left side, which is good. See how I do this? I start from the right side, right? It's like starting a standard calligraphy stroke, always at the pass. And then the left side. Sometimes my eye cannot see my brush tip. That's okay. You have to use your confidence, your mind to paint. Okay, here's another thing I want to mention. You can do the inner line, inner contour same time, but they are thinner, about half of the size of the contour. So the outer contour is But you can also leave that with for later. You can do that with a color line, you know, like a pink or something later. But you can do it. What do you think?
So
the folds, the kind of the wrinkle or
something. I would like to do that with a color.
With a color, yeah. We just do the outer contour at this point, okay? And I like the drawing you prepared. So the one on top in the front is heavier than the one behind, right? It's very clear. The subtle variation in thickness. Okay, this one is very clear, the little cut, the N shape, right? So you start from the left or right, one side first. And then the other side, leave a little room, or you know, occasionally I do have it closed, that's okay. You know, you don't have to, you know the rule, or you can break it. As long as you start from, you treat that as the beginning of the stroke, it's fine. So kind of dot it first. So you can make frequent passes in between and the turning points. You don't have to hold your breath all the way, but you know, you can have several little passes if you want. I'll try to repeat that you could if you know what you're doing. Okay, so always identify. I think you make very clear where the ends meet, right? So just go with that. It's a little heavier on the front, on the tip, and getting lighter pressure in the end. Right? If you do white flower in xieyi or spontaneous style, you may just make it 10 times thicker. It's the same thing, just make it thicker. We call it freestyle.
Yeah.
It's the same idea. Fine line, because the line is fine. We call that gombi. Gombi means fine line. This is what we are doing first. This is also called bone. If you do it without the outline or the bone, it's called boneless. Moku. Here is another very interesting pedal. So first of all, it's a foreshortened view, right, of a pedal that's we only see part of it, the head of it, right? So still you can see where the end, the beginning is, right here. So on both sides, but it's very foreshortened. And then there's a little inside section there. And then the bottom. Alright. And then just finish all this. As long as you have the drawing done, it's very pretty, you know, just trace it. And I'm glad you have a overlapping here. And on the final version you seem to avoid that. But that's okay. So which one is in the front goes first, basically.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's what you do first. But since you have the draft, it doesn't really matter as long as they don't conflict, they don't create a hard cross, you know, confuse the front and the back. You can do nice example. Okay. None of the pedals are the same. They're either, you know, have a thinner or thicker by themselves or in a perspective. So this is a very good example of a magnolia I tend to hold the brush too low, so I have trouble to draw this long line. Try to hold it higher.
Okay. I'm choking up on it too. Then I feel like I don't have control.
Right. I think you can also draw this with a slightly slant, like dragging instead of, you know, painting perpendicular stroke. It's all, I have seen one of my students, Maribel, I'm following her on Facebook. She started a few years ago in my class, but she kept learning Gombe only. So she draws perfect outline, better than mine. It just takes practice. She was here sometimes with me in the portrait class, Gombe portrait class. And she was doing great. And then, so it just takes practice. So behind and front, this is another example. And to draw two things, I have to repeat a little bit.
Is it okay to go on top? Is that going right?
Yeah, you can, but try not to let people know you did that. If you could. I try. Yeah. Try. All right. So, I think I tend to draw this vein with very thin lines. I think it's good to have. It's very. It kind of divides the light dark side on some of the feathers. So I draw it with a fine a dotted line, maybe not as strong as continuous, but I do want to draw like hair thin lines. But I think you did very good job, just like very thin line, some, you know, lost in the font. Just very, very light. I think you did very excellent.
Thank you.
Excellent preparation. And you can use even lighter ink. I think the ink is light. So I just drawing those lines. I just keep one line. Okay. There might be multiple lines on the photo, but we simplify that. Just draw the middle vein. It's not in the middle though, it depends on the perspective, right?
Are you doing every petal?
Not necessarily.
Okay.
Just the words you need.
I went into the
part. That part, yeah, I think we need to make it with a little darker, so that's why I haven't done that yet.
Then I should be okay.
Okay. Okay, let's do that. With a little darker ink, I'm going to add some more ink. Okay, just add a little pure ink there. Alright. So we draw this, what is it called, the seeds, or part, right? I think you did very good on this one. There's a little shoot, kind of, right?
Yeah, it's
like a bud, kind of, there's some dots.
Do you
want to
see the folding?
It's okay, I think this is what I need. I just need the outline. And just draw these little seeds. I think you did a very good now it's job much easier, I suppose, to do this in the class, right?
Oh, I enjoy doing that.
So this is a...
Oh, I've seen how you're actually...
Yeah, you can use a little thicker line. I think the... I tend to draw too fine. Maybe my brush is too fine. But you can enhance it later. There's a style that you know you can draw very fine, like Professor Rao in my lesson. You know, she draws very, very thin lines, almost disappear in the end. But traditionally, the line is there more to stay. So that's the flower. I will do the butt and then the other flower. But we have to go back to the lighter.
Oh,
gray.
You already darkened it up.
Yeah, no problem. Let me see. This flower actually is darker. It's like purple.
It is.
The young, yeah. They turn from purple to white when the blossom gets older, right? But in the beginning, it's like purple. So we can use dark. It's no problem. So I will do this foreshortened one. It's the most challenging one. So. You can see I think this picture is much clearer. Yeah. Okay, this foreshortened one I'll do first. You got some comments? Okay, well, we don't have time to reply you. Anyway, if you have questions, you can post the question later, we'll answer later. Okay, I have to do this. This line, I will make it like a, it should be curved. Do you have a better picture? Oh, I see. Oh, yeah, it is like curved up. So just curve up. So there's a center line goes like that. It's where a dividing line of the two sides. Okay. And then the back of the petal. Yeah, we should do the center dividing line, I think. Okay, let me just actually this fuzzy one is the calyx, right? With lots of hair.
Oh yeah, it's underneath.
Yeah, this one, let me see what we do. We can, I think maybe I'll just use your, we can use a thicker line to begin with and then make little texture dots on that. But you can also leave some brick, leave the outline some, you know, with some brick to put some dots in the line, like a hair.
Well, she can add that now.
Yeah, you can add that later or if you want. It should be darker ink. We should use darker ink. Anyway, I like the way you interpret it. So the photo shows the inside on top more on the back, but you can do that with less less backside, most upside, the face side.
I changed it a little bit.
I like that.
Far.
Yeah.
Okay.
That elaborates the start, the Chinese perspective. You're not supposed to look at the flower from bottom up. You look at it more at eye level.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. Perfectly. Okay. Yeah. So don't be fooled by the the distort, distort form. Try to return it to you know, what's true with your understanding. I have a suggestion that, you know, if you take that photo a little, you can see the petals, you know, a little. This is too close to in shape, so we need to vary. First of all, I need to make sure which one is in the front. But I think the left one is more in the front, so we can put this line belongs to the middle line should belongs to the left petal. Okay, so that's what I say.
You want it bigger?
Yeah, I want to save one side for the second petal behind. So you want, you don't want to make the two petals exactly side by side. You know what I mean? So I try to make this part, you know, the right petal partially hidden, right? Behind the left one. You know what I mean? So this middle line belongs to the left one. You can do the opposite if you like, but you don't have to. I like the original photo too. I add this little petal behind back, so that one just on the right side of the, on the left side. Okay, and I like this one you added, this nice addition. It's not in the original photo, but you did it very nicely. Okay. I almost like Xie Yi, you know, I like the freedom of the Xie Yi, the freestyle, spontaneous style. But you don't repeat the line. You don't draw, you write. We call it, you know, writing instead of painting.
This is more tracing.
Yeah, you're tracing, you don't have any life or vitality in the line. But the writings are, you know, like calligraphy, you give it a life, yeah, with the word kind of calligraphy. Yeah. Okay.
Can I see this?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like to see the picture. I almost feel like I'm looking at the real flower. My photocopy of my work. Digital reference. It's good. Simplify the calyx. So there are actually more than two, but you just use two. That's good.
Okay,
I got it. I think I got it. That's okay. Now I will dot this this calyx with some hair. So the next thing is to turn off this. I'm going to do this, I call this little buds, leaf buds or what, flower buds. They're kind of like a fuzzy edge, so I don't want to really outline it, I just dot it. To use dots as a line, to kind of circle it with dots. You can put the more dots inside the bud. You can have some sense of the shading if you want, but not necessarily in the Western lighting theory, you know, with directional lights. Which is, maybe the lower part is shady, so generally. Not single light source. Okay. Meanwhile, I'll do the branches. There are two ways to do the branch. Actually, you can do without the outline using we call it mogul, you know, and you draw directly with a dark gray and then dot some brown or green, blue color, kalashikomi or dripping. That would be nice, actually, but let me just see. I think let's just outline it, because you have a nice outline already. But this line is woody, right? So you can draw with a thicker and stronger line. Drier brush to indicate the kind of quality. You can even draw some wrinkle texture to add to that. You can also draw some knots, some bars or scars, kind of thing. Or lichens actually. But you can do that with later with the color or ink wash. But it's good to have some texture. I think the texture should be horizontal, like cherries, or maybe not. Vertical or horizontal, or just the.
Can you see? A little bit of both.
Yeah, I think it's some horizontal, some, let's just do the horizontal, just like that, and some vertical maybe as well. Just create some roughness, that's it. The contour is double contour, double line, and you can just add some fine line texture. You have pauses between sections. Each section could be varied in distance. Here we have some more, leaf buds, maybe, or flower buds. So I don't do online, I just dot it dot the contour and dot some inner texture. This one is a definitely a flower but like this. It has some it should have the, I would do this one as the calyx. Is this too, let me see, this one is also calyx.
Oh, it is, yeah.
Yeah, this one, this, they have big, yeah, big, 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 big. So this one is a very heavy line. And I got this hair. Finally, the petal inside. I'll use a little lighter. Just a little tiny water to it. We have a petal line here. I want to vary that. Maybe I'll just omit to the center one. Just middle one.
Just one?
Yeah, I just treat that middle one as a maybe fine. Partial line, you don't have to extend that all the way down. I'll squeeze out the control. This is a fine one. So vary the thickness, maybe just using a very fine line. The contour, outside contour is thicker. And then a fine one in the middle, that's all I want. Okay, I think I finished the outline and we just add some texture. Maybe we don't need much. We will use darker ink to color it anyway. You can dot some moss dots if needed to adjust. Characteristic of Chinese brush painting. It's called moss dots. It's like light and like that. So how's yours gonna occur? Let me turn off the light so you can see my work. I see it. Okay. Maybe a little too heavy, but I try to make distinction between the flower line and the woody lines and the fuzzy, we call that buds, leaf shoots. Okay, here's one. You can have a final check and see if you missed anything. Reinstate or yeah, I try to reinstate the contour, which is different than the inside thought. Anyway, some part is not necessary. You know, the whole thing is more important than the details. Of it. Okay, so let me take the under painting off and we can use felt to do the wash. Okay, you don't have to use the tape anymore. Careful, the tape is quite sticky. It's a surgical. Someone suggested me to do this.
Yeah.
It's not supposed to leave residual as the other tape, but still, it's, if you press too hard, it's hard to
take it
off. Yeah, just be careful. It. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Alright, let me move the mic. I don't need this. Are people watching this? Okay, that's the YouTube channel. Right? Let me focus more on my hand. Found two copies here.
Oh, there they are.
Okay. Yeah. Now I have a clean copy. Let me take a picture so you can use that as template. I mean, my students.
Yeah.
Let me use my camera. Yeah, I have the digital card.
Oh yeah.
Yes. You can I'll pass around. That's the pencil I think it will be considered as a draft. And this ink copy is the template. You can save it. You know, you can make another ink copy. This is a clean copy that you can use for template. That's for sure. So I will use ink more then the pencil is my master copy or template for future, okay? You want to take a picture with your phone? My phone is not free. Because when we colors, you will lose the online version. Yeah. Now we're going to continue to the next step. I'm going to use two brushes, one with color, one with water. We call that separate wash. You may have heard this. I watched this before with my other Gombe class. Let me see when we start. For the white flower, you can do the white first, and then use color to gradate it, to add like shadow to it. You can also do the opposite. You do the color first, and then you add color. Add white. For the purple one, I think we can do. Maybe we use different approach.
Yeah, see how it works.
So let's do the small flower first. Okay, that purple flower. Let me see. Where's the color photo? The one you the crop. Color pictures. This one is very clear. So I'm going to use a little color from this new color I carried on our website. It's a sakura or cherry blossom, you know, Japanese brand. It's a very famous brand. And they have a joint venture with the Shanghai Chinese company. They formed a company to produce for the Chinese market, the Chinese painting, the sakura Chinese painting colors. What this color is they have developed the artificial binding, new binding material. It replaced the traditional gelatin that the animals grew. So it will not dry so easily as the traditional tubed color. It won't get hard.
Oh, that's nice.
Although the, you have to pay for the cost. It's like 3 times more expensive. Anyway, and you have some new colors like the gold. It does not have in the traditional Chinese painting color, but all the other mostly are the same. And we have the Chinese white titanium. Mm-hmm. Titanium white. That's what I'm going to use, and some. We'll make it's not purple, right? It's light purple, or
purplish pink.
Pink, yeah. We can use the rouge, or maybe we can just blend. We can use carmine, and maybe some. Oh, I like this new color. This is maybe ultramarine. Yeah, cobalt or mushroom, whatever. That is maybe opaque, maybe not. Okay, let me blend this to see if it works for the purple. I have this ultramarine color. Let me try it. I haven't used it before. This is ultramarine. It's called a fortune. The Japanese name. And comma. See how it works. You can also have some purple for the dark. Oh, this is too dark. Maybe you cannot really get the best purple. You have to mix them. Okay, let's do. To make it clear, let me use a different colored brush. You don't have to use the soft brush all the time. You can use the stiff one, maybe. I'll just use my two basic brushes. One is the soft goat hair, and one is the wolf hair. I always use the wolf hair for color deliver or charger. Right? So let me mix this to get a purple. Is this good enough?
Too purple.
More blue. I think maybe we should keep them separated so you can adjust the proportion. Alright, let me wet this one also. So this brush is to serve as a sponge. So I wet it, then I dry it, keep it damp, but not dripping. No, not too much. But I will use this is purple now.
You want more purple?
More blue? Mm-hmm. Like this?
Oh, that's up to you. I was going more pink.
Oh, purple means more pink? Oh,
wait,
I got
we can do purple.
Alright, let me do this. Okay. It's cool. Yeah. Maybe you just the warm and the cold.
Yeah.
You want more warmer?
What do you think? Yeah, I'm thinking more warmer.
Too much.
We won't use it all.
Okay, that's good. So you can we can share. You can use it for the brush. Okay. So here's what I do. I hold the brush in one hand and switch them when I need. You can use if you cannot use it, you can use your left hand holding the brush and then switch it back and forth. It's much convenient if you. It needs some practice, so you may learn practice later. The under part is darker, right? So let's do that. I would I think it's more like a backlit, so the center is also darker. vein. Maybe the vein is darker than the site. So, and then, so I apply dark purple to the center. Then I use clean brush to kind of pull it towards the margin. Is that what looks realistic enough? And you can do maybe one side is darker than the other. Also, maybe a little bit on the lower part as well. So, see, I apply the color and then I use clean brush, the sponge brush, to gradate it. So it's as if, you know, as if it's done in one shot, but not. You have to use two separate brushes. We call it a separate wash. The purpose is to create the gradation, to gradate.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
It's not pulling out, so I don't know if I don't have enough.
You don't have enough
color
to charge it. So this color brush has to deliver enough color. It's kind of create a pool of color.
Okay, so fill my brush?
Yeah, fill it. Okay. That's why I got so many,
okay.
So much color for you.
Don't worry about
you need more than, yeah, it's full there.
Okay.
So you kind of drip on the,
drip on the
paper, and then you pull it from that pool. So in the beginning, don't worry about the shape, just deliver the color. So I just deliver the color. You see, this is not a line, it's a, if you look at the closely, you can see that line is very, let me just focus on my hand just so people can really see it. Okay, so I use this clean brush to pull the brush, to push the brush, to pull the brush around, away from the center. And you can dry the brush, you can clean, dab it in the water and dry it, because it will get stained, right? So you can clean it if needed. And then just do another. So if it's too wet, it will deliver water to the paper, that's not good. So in the end of that sponge brush stroke, there should be no excessive on the paper. It will take away the paint instead of adding water to it. Okay. The paint is added with the first color stroke, color brush. So let me do this again. This is the back of that foreshortened, banded. So this is clean that brush. So my sponge brush should be always clean, so you can clean it in water if it gets dirty. So you will take, and it's relatively dry, not so wet, so you will serve as a blender. Okay? Let me do this again. So the center, and then switch to the clean brush, push to the side. And you can leave a little highlight on top. Okay, let me do another one. This one, you see the back is dark. So I use color first on the back. But the middle is light. Okay, so I just put some color on the top. And I push along the side. On the top side, and just leave the center white to create that kind of white center feel. Okay, let me put this reference on the table so you can see. You don't have to copy exactly the photo, but this gives you some inspiration. I think the center is white. This one you see most white because the frog gets white. use your left hand to hold the and use the brush and just take turn.
I'm trying, but I don't want to.
Yeah, you will draw it. I know. I learned from Professor Rao 3 years ago in China. She showed me how to do it. You know, when you do it quickly, you don't really know. If the brush is the same, you cannot even tell that he's just doing
which
that. Yeah, but you can hear the sound, da, 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 like that. I'm not a Gombe artist myself, but it's never too late to learn. Actually, Gombe is easier than Xie Yi, you think, because you have more control. You need more patience. Oops, I think I made it too dark. That's okay. Sometimes you don't have to worry about the real what's what. You more concentrate on the group, the effect, the total. Sponge brush gets too much color, so I need to clean that. Yeah, I need to. I think to make it easier, you just make the uniform color, because I try to separate the two. Actually, it's not so much contrast. It's not like the purple magnolia I've seen, the white and the dark side. But this one is subtle, so you don't have to really. It's a wild mountain version of magnolia.
Yeah, it's different. It's a thin leaves.
It's not the kind of contrast. So we just make the center a little heavier, maybe side a little heavier. As long as you have some tonal value change, that's okay.
I have a question.
Sure.
You don't go back over top of something that's wet, is that correct? You have to wait till it dries?
Yeah, basically you do it in multiple layers.
Okay.
You can add more, but sometimes, you know, you can go back right away.
It's okay.
Right.
If I want to make this darker, do I have to wait?
You can do it right away if you want.
We'll try it and see.
Yeah, you can try it. If it
doesn't work, we try another one.
Yeah. Yeah, I think the darkest you can enhance it later. For this point, because they are not really dark, to get the really essence, you need to go back later. Battery out 15%. So yeah, we have to make a break and we'll come back. I'll charge my phone, otherwise I cannot control my camera. The camera is still working. Oh yeah, I have to use network on my phone. So I'll see you later. Thanks for watching.